Tony, I'll let you introduce. You read the booklet, and so what are your criticisms about overstatements and rhetoric?
Well, I just remember when you were a student with us back in 2006, 2007, you were actually a favorite topic among the faculty because you seemed to be quite combative at that time. You were a Christian, and you were obviously very concerned about things that were going on in the church. I guess this was laying the foundation for your eventual deconversion. But I remember a distinct conversation with you once about just how much pastors are paid, and you were very troubled about some of the mega church pastors being paid high sums of money. You really couldn't justify that in your mind. And when I asked you to try to defend that, and what would a justifiable salary be, you really couldn't come up with one that I recall, and I accused you of barking up a tree and having no evidence for what you were barking about. And so it's similar what I see here in this particular document. You know, we're going to talk first of all about rhetoric, and being I'm also the director of the Doctor of Ministry program at the school, and I head up research and writing and teach that course. And at the doctoral level, we demand a lot of evidence and support for statements that we make. And you make a lot of what I call overstatements in this particular treatise that you've written here. Some of them are actually gross overstatements. Grand and complemented with that is grandiose assertion. Even the title of it, Modern Science Destroys Christianity. Well, obviously, this is an overstatement. It doesn't destroy it. It might raise some interesting questions or some challenging discussion topics, but it doesn't destroy it. Your 10-page treatise is not going to wipe out Christianity and the tenets of Christianity. You know, the 5,000-year history of Judeo-Christianity is not going to be wiped out in your assertions about what you think does or does not make up valid evidence. And so that's one aspect of it. You know, I would think that you would say that modern science raises challenging questions or something like that. Another massive overstatement, just from your own writings, these are your words. Everything I wrote is sufficient to show that Christian theology no longer survives in light of modern science. To argue otherwise shows some kind of ignorance in science, either in biological evolution or neurology. Again, this is an overstatement. Everything I wrote is sufficient that to show that Christianity or Christian theology no longer survives. I think that's a little bit extreme. You don't defend that statement. You give very general analysis of what you think the evidence for evolution is, what you think the evidence for neurology is, and things of that nature. But a massive overstatement like that is, again, just not good rhetoric on your part. Let me give you one last example, or another example, and then I'll give you an opportunity to respond. You say, now that we know how the brain functions, there is no homunculus, which is obviously another word for the soul. There is no master controller overlooking everything and making decisions. So what you're doing here is you're making a statement and drawing an assumed conclusion within that statement. But you don't have any scholarly support for the statement. It's just an overstatement. You're just saying, we know how the brain functions, and therefore there is no soul, and therefore there is no God. And there's much more to that dialogue than just that statement. So those are just a few examples of what I would consider the overstatement or grandiose assertion.
Okay, thank you for that. You know, I've done quite a few debates, and one thing I've been learning is that I think it's really good for people to have a dialogue, because a lot of times in debates, people give one, you know, their position, then the other side gives their position, and they don't ever have a dialogue, and so the person watching is like, well, you know, what's the remark on that? So in our discussion, we might want to try to focus in on certain things and not like have a shotgun approach, because then there's too many things to talk about, we're going to run out of time. So yeah. I did want to briefly discuss every issue you brought up. One is, you said when I was in the seminary, there was some faculty discussion about me. That's kind of funny for me, because I had no idea about that, you know, whatsoever. Oh. You know. Then as far as, some of these pastors making too much money, what I did at the time was I made a chart, because I had my own 501c3 Christian preaching ministry, and I wanted to find out what a reasonable salary was. And so I did a chart of all the salaries, and then people like John Hagee stood way out. He had over $1 million salary. And then as far as what's reasonable salary, well, that's actually pretty easy to answer. I think I even gave you the answer at the time. It's by looking at the chart, it's very easy to see what averages are and where things lie. And so for Hagee, for example, he was just off the charts. It was just crazy. And, you know, and usually it's like the limit is like 150,000 or so. So a million is like, you know, it's almost 10 times that. You know, and you said I have a lot of overstatements. For example, it's kind of funny because, for example, I'll say something like, any kind of overstatement like science destroys philosophy. It's kind of interesting because you say that's an overstatement, but there's a lot of atheists who read my document, and they're saying like, well, duh, there's nothing new here. So it's kind of interesting. Everybody I'm going to talk to, I'm going to have a different conversation with, depending on what they want to talk about. When I said everything I wrote is enough to, all the science I wrote is enough to disprove Christian theology, one thing I want to note is that most Christians, evangelical Christians especially, reject evolution. And if they were to accept evolution, I think that would destroy their theology. And that's the reason why I think there's such a animosity towards evolution. And yes, and the booklet, I do acknowledge that there are Christians who fully accept modern science, and this would be an example of Biologos, for example, or Dennis Venema on YouTube, who tries to explain evolution to people. And that's where I go on and say that now let's look at philosophy, and we're going to talk about that in our third one, the problem of evil.
Okay.
And then as far as the brain functioning, yeah, I kind of spaced out on our previous discussion. We should have actually had that as a separate topic, because that alone is by itself is a big thing. But my point there is that with modern neurology, it's from a naturalistic viewpoint, it makes perfectly sense that the mind emerges from the brain. You know, for example, when a baby's conceived, there's no mind because there's no neurons. And then when the baby's born, the neurons are a little bit more, but there's still not much consciousness. And then, you know, we just see this consciousness emerging, and then actually, as they get older, they go into dementia. And if this was all seen naturalistically, it all makes perfectly sense. But to say that there was some kind of spirit given to you as a soul, then there's all these kind of weird problems, like, you know, what happens if you're retarded and you die? Are you going to be retarded in heaven? And or if you're an infant when you die, and all these things about identical twins.
I actually was prepared to talk about that and maybe in the next section, but since you brought it up, I mean, you make that statement in your booklet here about if a child is born retarded, will it be retarded in heaven? If someone is senile and they die, well, they're going to be senile in heaven. Well, the answer to that is of course not. You're trying to make heaven a fleshly realm, and there's a huge distinction between the earthly realm and the heavenly realm. And obviously a child who's born in childbirth, I mean, it's not going to be a child forever and eternity in a place called heaven, and certainly someone's not going to be senile. I'm 52. If I were to die tonight, I don't think I would be 52 in the afterlife or in heaven. I think I would be whatever God wanted to make me. This mortal shall put on immortality is what the scripture says, and that back in the garden, if we go back even to the idea of original creation, that perfect, there was no age, there was no dying, supposedly at the original plan of God. Restored in heaven, there is no age, there is no death, there is no pain, there is no suffering. So to equate how we live in this life or how we die in this life to what's going to be like in that life is not even on the same page of dialogue. So I was really kind of surprised that you actually put it in your document, because you know that any theologian, the first thing they're going to say to you is, you can't equate the here and now to the afterlife.
Okay, so maybe we can spend just a couple minutes on this one topic. So in this world, let's consider one thing we can consider is that the natural miscarriage rate is something really high. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but it's like 75% or so. Which there are so many natural miscarriages that a lot of men are miscarrying without even knowing they're pregnant, and it's like 70% or so. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in this life, we understand that if a child was born here in America versus born in anywhere, and even in a different family, they're going to be a different person based on their environment. This is the idea of emergence. So now, if this thing miscarried and then died and their soul went to heaven, how could there possibly be any, I mean, how could this thing grow into some kind of mentality?
Well,
I mean,
again,
you know, like on Earth, it'd be totally different depending on where they live. So how would that be on heaven?
Well, again, you're equating the here and now to the afterlife, and there is no comparison between the two. I can't speak to the subject of miscarriage to an overly intelligent degree because, there again, that is not a subject related to what we're talking about in the sense of that soul is actually developing and have an opportunity to live life. That is a subject that I would equate to the ramifications of the fall, that life is now because the fall of man, the sin of man that entered into the world and God allowed us to live in the natural realm more than the spiritual realm. There's going to be pain and suffering, and miscarriage is a part of that. But the joy of knowing Christ as Savior, the joy of having eternal life, is the knowledge and the hope that one day we will be free from the bondages of this life and the pains of this life and the sufferings of this life, and that in heaven, where it says in the book of Revelation, there is no longer any death and no longer crying. The former things have passed away. All things have become new. And you can write these things down because they're faithful and true. Jesus said to John, and he was writing those words. So, you're not equating apples and oranges. You're equating two entirely, or you're equating apples to oranges. You're two entirely different playing fields. There's a huge difference between the here and now and the fleshly realm and the eternal.
Well, I guess part of the problem is it seems like the word soul is not really defined. I mean, you know, like with the other case too, if somebody's 80 years old and they're suffering dementia, what are they going to be in like in heaven? And you know, some preacher might say like, well, perfect. it's like when they're in their 30s and they're at the peak of life. But it's like, well, maybe their peak physically.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but this is very simple. In heaven, they will be perfect. They will be completed. That's what heaven is about. It is the completion of the work of Christ.
But
if you are living in dementia in this life, you won't be living in dementia because the former things have passed away. The sin and the wickedness of this world will have been given away, thrown away, cast away, tossed aside for the glory of the eternal with the Lord Jesus. That's what the Scripture teaches. That's what Christians believe. That's what their hope is in. This very world is what gives them the hope of a beautiful, perfect future.
Yeah, but I'm not thinking of it from an aspect of perfection or imperfection. I'm thinking of it from an aspect of identity, like everybody has a different personality.
Mm-hmm.
So how would they develop a personality when our personality is shaped by our surroundings?
Well, I can agree with that wholeheartedly. I'm the person I am largely because of who raised me and the experiences of my life, where I was educated. I wasn't educated in Peru, so I don't have the minds of people who live in South America or parts of South America. But it still doesn't have anything to do with whether or not your emergence theory carries any weight into the afterlife. Who I am in the here and now is where God once wanted me to be. He wanted me to be born in Nashville, Tennessee, and be raised up in Tennessee, and then live this portion of my life in the Atlanta metro area teaching at the seminary. I accept that as God's sovereign plan. The fact that I wasn't raised somewhere else, or if I was raised somewhere else and would have been a different person, it's still irrelevant to the point. I still would have been where God wanted me to be, doing what God wanted me to do, and following His plan for my life. It's a pretty simple question to answer.
Well, I guess, you know, just another aspect of the way I'm looking at it is from a matter of personality. When I look at my life, my personality changes. There is no core personality. It changes. And for example, at one time I was an ardent Christian, and now I'm an ardent atheist. There's no way to, it's not like Microsoft Windows where you can go back to a restore point. I'm a different person in time. And so I just don't understand life, when you have a soul, what your personality would be like.
Yeah, but now you are contradicting the science of human development. All human development theorists tell us that our foundational personality is developed in the first 4 to 6 years of life. You might express it differently at times in your life, but the person that you basically are is the same throughout your lifetime. Your likes are the same. Your interests are pretty much the same. They might alter. They might develop. But your formative years are those first 4 to 6 years of life. This is scientific theory found in every textbook on human development. So you're contradicting the very science that you claim to espouse.
Well, when I was younger and went to high school and college, I was very interested in electronics, and now I don't really have any kind of interest in that, and more of philosophy. So, you know, this is, and of course, when I'm 4 years old, I wouldn't predict any of that because I didn't even know what philosophy was.
Well, again, change in interest is not change in personality. Those are two different things.
At one time
in my life, I was a devout musician, but now I'm a public speaker, preacher, communicator. Both of those are very similar things because they both allow me to use creativity, put me on the stage in front of people, allow me, and you're doing something different with it. Just the same aspect of your personality, just used in a different way. It doesn't mean that you are becoming a different person. It certainly doesn't mean that in the afterlife, it has ramifications for that. Whatever you are in the now is just who you are in the here and the now.
I would think that what I do has a huge impact on my personality. Like if I'm working on designing computers versus studying philosophy, I think that has a huge impact on personality.
Okay.
Well, so anyway, so maybe we'll go on to the next one. I mean, we're not going to probably agree on anything, but it's just nice to have a discussion. I appreciate
that. I'm enjoying it.
Okay, so the second one is,